Well, the passage that we're going to be looking at this morning is found in Matthew chapter 11. We're going to be looking at a rather interesting verse in Matthew 11, verse 12. But I'd like to read for you the context beginning in verse 1. I'd like to read Matthew 11, verses 1 through 15. Would you please listen carefully to this? This is God's Word. When Jesus had finished giving instructions to his 12 disciples, he departed from there to teach and preach in their cities. Now when John, while imprisoned, heard of the works of Christ, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the expected one, or shall we look for someone else?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who does not take offense at me." As these men were going away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Those who wear soft clothing are in kings' palaces. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and one who is more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you.' Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and violent men take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to accept it, John himself is Elijah who was to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Now, there are a number of things in this particular passage that I've just read, but we're going to focus on verse 12 in particular. What does it mean that from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and violent men take it by force? Well, as I've already mentioned, we've been looking at the command that our Lord Jesus Christ has given to us. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And he says that if we will do this, everything else that we need will be given to us. What is the secret of having our needs met? From the present until the time when we leave this world, Jesus says, do this, and he says, I will take care of your needs. We need to put the kingdom first. And the Lord then will take care of our needs. Now, that is what he calls us to do. We've also seen something of how it is we are to do this. The Lord has given us a map to follow, basically a step-by-step plan, how to get from point A to point B. His word, he's given us a description of what Jesus himself did, a blueprint for the Christian life. We are to live by the Word of God. That is how we are to seek it, the kingdom of heaven. Jesus says in Matthew 4, verse 4, in his response to the enemy, who was seeking to get him to do something other than what God's Word says, he says this, "Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." So how are we to seek the kingdom of heaven? We must do it by the Word. Now, he told us that in order to do this, we need to have faith. Faith to follow the Word, faith to believe what it actually says. Now, sometimes it looks like if we actually do what the Lord calls us to do, that we're going to lose out. We're going to miss some of the fun, some of the pleasures that the world has to offer, some of its glory. Faith tells us, on the other hand, that we're not really going to miss out on anything, at least nothing of any value. But we are going to gain that which is truly valuable, and that is riches in heaven. Jesus told us that we need hope. Not the kind of hope that says, I'm not sure this is true, but I hope it is. But that which says, I know that these things are true because the Lord has promised it, and so I look forward with the expectancy that I will receive it. And he's told us that if we are to make this journey, as we saw last week, we need to resist the flesh, the old sinful desires, what's left over of the old man, and we need to give into, we need to yield to, we need to follow the Spirit of God, the new desire that he puts in our hearts for that which is good, with the confidence that the Lord is going to help us to do what is good, because we know that if we don't do what is good, that the Lord will bring just the right corrective measures in order to get us back on the path. In other words, God is going to use his fatherly discipline. Because he loves us, he's going to make sure we stay on the path. So we have the Lord's help to help us keep moving forward. Now this morning, I want us to continue to look at how we are to seek the kingdom by considering the degree of effort that we are to put into seeking it. In other words, how we are to do our best, put our best efforts into it to seek the kingdom of heaven. Well, let's begin by asking the question, how much effort does the Lord actually call us to put out? Well, I've already told you, he calls us to do our very best. Now, last week, the author to the Hebrews told us that there was a race that we are to run, fixing our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. We are to look to him for our example of how we are to live. We are to look to him for the strength we need in order to run this race. But I want you to notice that he does say that we are to run. The Christian life is not one of walking, although sometimes it is referred to as walking, walking with the Lord, walking according to truth, walking in the light. But we also have these images that connote or denote effort. It takes more effort to run than it does to walk. Now, the author used a word here that means to rush forward, to strive to advance, something that requires a good deal of effort. And we know that that is not the only place in Scripture where we hear our Lord calling us to do this. We've already seen one in our meditation this morning, or another. When someone asked Jesus whether there are only a few that would be saved, he replied in this way in Luke 13:24, strive to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. Now, the word he uses here is one from which we get our English word, agonize. Agonize to enter through the narrow door. It means to fight, to struggle, to make every effort, to try very hard to do your very best. And of course, we see the same idea in our passage this morning. Jesus says in Matthew 11, verse 12, from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and violent men take it by force. Now, what does Jesus mean by that? Is he basically saying that a bunch of wicked men are trying to get into the kingdom and they're succeeding, they're breaking down the doors and getting in? No. But rather, he is talking about the kind of effort that is being put into pursuing the kingdom of heaven now that the kingdom has come. Remember, the Old Testament was pointing to Jesus, and we've been seeing that as we've been reading the Bible together and looking at the Old Testament books. We're looking for pictures of Jesus, all these prophecies, types, and promises of the coming Messiah. The Old Testament was pointing to Jesus, but once John came, he began to announce the coming of the one the Old Testament was talking about. Jesus appears preaching the gospel of the kingdom. The kingdom is now present in the person of the king. And what Jesus is saying here is that those now who see that the kingdom is present in him, and those who see its value, whose eyes were opened by God to see it as the treasure hidden in the field, or as the pearl of great price, began selling all that they had in order to possess it, which means they began to press into it with all their might, like violent men trying to take the kingdom. In a parallel passage in Luke 16, verse 16, Jesus says this, "The law and the prophets were proclaimed until John. Since that time, the gospel of the kingdom has been preached, and everyone is forcing his way into it." Essentially, that's exactly what he is telling us in our passage. Once the kingdom is present, once the kingdom of heaven is now being preached, that men everywhere, not each and every individual, but all kinds of people are pressing into it. They began to do whatever was necessary in order that they might enter into that kingdom, in order they might take it, in order they might possess it and have that treasure, which is, again, like the treasure buried in the field or like the pearl of great price. They're willing to give up everything in order to have it. Now, what does Jesus mean here when he says that we must offer violence to the kingdom, that we have to force our way into it, that we have to put out such great effort in order to enter it? I mean, think about what the gospel actually teaches us after all. Isn't it true that if we've trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, if we've turned from our sins and believed in him and looked to him as our only hope of heaven, that we are already in the kingdom of heaven? Well, there is a sense in which that is true, of course, but there's also a sense in which it isn't true, at least not in the sense that Jesus is talking about in our passage. Now, yes, it is true that if we have trusted him, we have entered into the kingdom of heaven, that we are citizens of the kingdom. Paul tells us that we're, as a matter of fact, already seated with Jesus in the heavenly places in Christ. We're already there because we're united to Jesus Christ, and thankfully nothing in heaven, earth, or under the earth can ever separate us from the Lord Jesus or the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. One day, we will actually be there by his grace. Now, that's one of the things that Jesus means when he says in Luke 13, 24, "Strive to enter through the narrow door." Jesus is the narrow door. Jesus said to Thomas in John 14, verse 6, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." So if you have come to Jesus, if you have trusted him to save you, and if you are following him, you have entered the kingdom already through the Lord Jesus Christ. You have entered through the narrow door. And let me just say that if you haven't yet done this, then one of the things Jesus is saying through this passage to you this morning is strive to enter by the narrow door. Make every effort to come to Jesus while you still can, and trust him, believe in him, turn from your sins, and he will open the door of the kingdom of heaven, and he will gladly bring you in. The Lord says that he will not turn away anyone who comes to him. Now, if we've trusted Jesus, we're already in his kingdom, but there's also a sense in which we are not yet in the kingdom, and that's what we want to look at for our purposes this morning. We have not yet entered into heaven. We have not yet entered into the eternal kingdom of God, into the new heavens and the new earth. And this is what Jesus is telling us that we must strive in order to do. Now, we do need to ask ourselves a question at this point. Does this mean that there's a work that we need to do to enter into the kingdom of heaven? Well, the answer to that question is yes. We have to press forward on the narrow path, Jesus tells us. We need to make every effort to enter through the narrow door into heaven. We must live as our Lord calls us to live. But now, how can there be a work for us to do and at the same time salvation be purely by grace alone? Now here's where we need to again put on our thinking caps and understand the relationship between faith and works. We do need to understand that what Jesus is calling us to here is not a work that earns our salvation. Jesus did everything that was necessary to save us through his life and through his death. Our running this race, our struggling to enter through the narrow door on this narrow path is not a work that we do to enter into heaven, but rather, or I should say that earns heaven, but it is the evidence that we have received the Lord Jesus and the salvation that is in him. It's the evidence, it's not the cause. And I would just again point you to James chapter 2, verse 26, that passage again that Luther had difficulty with as he was trying to understand the relationship between faith and works. He says this, "For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead." If we have a saving faith, we will have a faith that is active. We will have a faith that produces fruit, that produces work, that produces this effort in order to enter into the kingdom of heaven, this putting of the kingdom first, and this pursuit of the kingdom with the kind of effort that our Lord is calling us to seek it with. Now, the other reason it's not salvation by works is because it's Jesus who is actually doing this work in us by his Holy Spirit. It's the same thing that Paul was talking about last week when he said in Galatians 5:16, "Walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh." Or when he says to the Philippians in Philippians 2, verses 12 through 13, "So then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling." Notice, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Is there work to be done? Well, yes, there is work. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Work your way to heaven? No, that's not what he's saying. But what he's saying is that if you've trusted Jesus, God is at work within you by his Holy Spirit to want to do what he calls you to do and actually to do those things. Now again, Jesus has done it all. He has worked out our salvation. He gives it to us as a free gift. We don't have to work for it. We don't have to pay for it. He offers it as a free gift, and we receive it freely by faith alone and not by works. Jesus has done it all, but Jesus does it all. He continues to do the work in us. He has given us his Spirit so that his Spirit may move us to do what it is the Lord calls us to do. And how does that work itself out in our lives? We do it all. It works itself out in that we strive to enter God's kingdom like violent men trying to take a city. We put that kind of effort into it. Now, this is just simply another way of saying that if we belong to Jesus, we will resist the flesh and we will yield to the Spirit. We will grow in our sanctification. We will become more like him. But the added element here is that we will do it with a great deal of effort. Not always. You know, there's going to be times when grace is strong in us and times when grace is weak in us, but the overall pattern will be that we will be putting effort into it. That will be our desire to move forward. Believing in the Lord Jesus Christ and entering into his kingdom through faith in his name is not the end of what he calls us to do. Again, there are Christians today and churches today, sadly, that think that all there is to the Christian faith is trying to convince somebody to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and once they do, the work is over. They're safely in the kingdom, nothing else to do. Well, it's not the end, coming to the kingdom through faith in Jesus. It's merely the beginning. Once we enter, the Lord tells us that we are to grow in grace. And in order to do this, we must fight against our earthly desires. We have to fight against the world, the flesh, and the devil. That's exactly what Paul did in his own life when he says in, I believe it's 1 Corinthians, boy, I put the wrong reference here, so it's confusing me, but I think it's the 1 Corinthians 9 and the last verse in the passage where he says, "But I discipline my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified." Does it appear to you that the Apostle Paul thought that just trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ was all there was to it? No, there was a struggle here. There was a battle going on. There was the disciplining of his body, he says. Sometimes he almost refers to the old nature and the sinful nature and the fleshly, the old man, as the physical body, but that's certainly how it expresses itself. He had to beat back the bodily appetites and make his body, as it were, his slave, so that he would be able to do what the Lord called him to do in preaching the gospel, and so that he would not be overwhelmed by those desires and in the end be destroyed by them. We have to put effort into it. We have to fight against our earthly desires. And at the same time, we need to fight to put on the character of our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, there's the old man to put off, and there is the old or the new man to put on. Again, Paul writes in Romans 13, verse 14, "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts." Paul already told us in 1 Corinthians 9:24 that we need to work at this as an athlete who is striving to gain the prize. He writes, "Run in such a way that you may win." And again, remember all the elements of disciplining yourself to be able to do this. We have to have focus. Verse 26 of 1 Corinthians 9. "Therefore I run in such a way as not without aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air." In other words, we need to do what our Lord Jesus Christ did when he ran his race. Remember, the Lord Jesus had his eyes resolutely set on the goal, and he didn't let up for a moment until he actually obtained that goal. Now, this is what our Lord calls us to do, to give our very best, to put our best effort into seeking the kingdom of heaven. But remember that this is his work in us. He has not called us to do this on our own. We don't have to pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps. We don't have to somehow muster within ourselves the strength to do this, although in a certain sense we do, because we need strength. But we need to look to the Lord for that strength. And he's given us everything we need to be strong. We've already seen he's given us his word to direct us, to show us which way to go. He's given us his Spirit to empower us. Without the Spirit, it'd be impossible to do any of this. We wouldn't want to do it. We need more of his Spirit, but he has promised to give us the Spirit if we simply ask. He's pledged to help us with his gracious correction if we happen to veer off course. We've already seen that. He welcomes us to the throne of grace in prayer to ask him for the things that we need. You realize that all of us, if we've trusted Jesus, have the right to come to his throne at any time and ask for whatever we need, and the Lord will give it to us. He reminds us of his love and his grace through the supper, and he promises to provide us with spiritual food when we come to him in faith. He's given us one another as an encouragement to one another so that we might be able to strengthen and lift each other up. And he's given us the promise that if we keep our eyes upon him and do what he calls us to do, that we will make it to heaven. So our Lord calls us to do our best. He's given us the ability to do our best. And if we ask him for help, he will help us to do our best. And so this is what we are to do. This is how we grow. This is how we become more like Jesus. This is how the kingdom grows, how more people are going to be saved from destruction and come to know him. This is how Jesus receives his reward, how he gathers his bride together is as his people seek the kingdom and put it first and put this effort into it. This is what the love that God has put into our hearts by his Holy Spirit will compel us to do. And I think this quote I'm going to read by Thomas Watson reminds us of why if Jesus has given us the Spirit, we have everything that we need to be able to do what Jesus says we must do with regard to striving to enter the kingdom of heaven, because he has given us love for the kingdom. And Thomas Watson reminds us that love is able to break through every impediment, every opposition, every barrier, and obtain the prize. Listen to what Thomas Watson writes. He says, love puts a man upon the full use of all means to enjoy the thing loved. He that loves the world, how active is he? He will break his peace and sleep for it. He that loves honor, what hazards will he run? He will swim to the throne in blood. Love heaven, and you cannot miss it. Love breaks through all opposition. It takes heaven by storm. Jesus has given us that love in our hearts for the kingdom of heaven, and that's why we not only can put this kind of effort into it, essentially, if we are believers, we will put this kind of effort into it, because this is what Jesus is doing in us. This is really what the Christian life is all about. It's a summary of the Christian life. It's running this race with this effort, seeking the kingdom of heaven, denying ourselves, putting everything else aside, and making that the focus of our lives. Well, again, may the Lord help us then to put that effort into it, to press forward into the kingdom, because, again, it is by that effort, which, again, is the Lord working through us, that the kingdom of heaven will actually advance in this world. And that is essentially what our Lord wants, and that's what we want. We want to see the kingdom of heaven advance, but it advances through our putting the kingdom first and putting out that effort to seek it as the Lord calls us to. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer and let's ask the Lord to help us to put that kind of effort into seeking the kingdom of heaven. And as we also pray, let's also pray that the Lord would prepare us to come to his table this morning, that we might receive the grace we need to be able to do this with more zeal and more effort.